Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Easter to you all. You know, I cannot think of a better way to start our Easter Sunday morning than with a baptism of a young man who has committed his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And we want to celebrate that this morning. I know that we are Southern Baptists, but I encourage you, when he comes up out of the water, let's rock this place. It's Easter Sunday. We need to celebrate that. This is a wonderful thing. And so I'm going to ask now if Lane, if you would, to come forward. Lane, who have you trusted in as your Lord and your Savior to save you from your sins?
Jesus.
Well, based upon your profession of faith and your desire to follow through in baptism, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Well, again, what a wonderful way to start our service this morning. I didn't have to pull the curtain this time, so that was not an issue, but Monty, if you would, lead us in prayer for this young man.
And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for this day. And Lord, I thank you for the symbolism of baptism and how it shows that our sins are buried and we rise to walk with you. Lord, I thank you for that symbolism that also comes with what you have done for us. Of being crucified, being buried, and rose again. Lord, thank you for paying for the penalty of our sins. Thank you for this morning. Help us as we are here. It's not to go through just the motions of Easter. It's not just knowing that we've heard this story many times before, but it's about the power of your love through what you did for us. Thank you again for this time. Thank you for the chance we have to be here this morning. Thank you for those that are online with us this morning. Thank you for your love, your forgiveness, your mercy and grace. For we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Please stand. We want to welcome you this morning, being here with us. We also want to welcome those that are online or with us as well this morning. I know we don't have first-time cards in the pews, but if you've got something, you're here for the first time, if you've got something you can write on, put it in the offering plate up front or in the back, we'd love for you to do that, just so we'll have a record of you being here, as well as we can send you some information about our church. So we... Again, we're glad you're here. We want you to feel welcome. Help us sing Man of Sorrows.
That rugged cross, my salvation.
of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed Him to that tree. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where Your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto Thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, may Your love pour out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto Thee. See, the stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised. He's risen from the grave. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where Your love poured out over me. My soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto Thee, praise and honor unto Thee.
Amen. You may be seated.
I'm going to be reading from first from Genesis chapter 22, several verses. Now it came about that after these things, that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. And he said, Take now your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go into the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will show you. And Abraham took the wood and the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife, so the two of them walked on together. And Isaac spoke to Abraham his father and said, My father. And he said, Here I am, my son. And he said, Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. And they came to the place of which God had told him, and Abraham built the altar there and arranged the wood and bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. And he said, Do not stretch out your hand against the lad, and do nothing to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham raised his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram was caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the place of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, The Lord Will Provide, as it is to this day. On the mount of the Lord it will be provided. Now in 2 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 1, Then Solomon began to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem on Mount Moriah. John chapter 1, verses 28 and 29. These things took place in Bethany beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day he saw Jesus coming to him and said, Behold, the Lamb of God who has taken away the sin of the world. In John 3:16, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. In Jerusalem, outside Jerusalem, on Mount Moriah, God provided his Son, his only Son. Let's pray, please. Almighty Father, we thank you that you loved us so much. You loved the world so much that you gave your Son, your only Son, the Son you loved, as a sacrifice that we might have salvation and a relationship with you. Father, for that, in the name of that Son, we thank you. Amen.
Before we sing our hymn this morning, we're going to do a responsive reading, and it's in your bulletin. It's an insert in your bulletin. It says, But he lives. Now, here's the thing. If you don't have a bulletin, don't worry, because if you remember, when I'll say my phrase, and when I'm done, you'll say, But he lives. Okay? But he lives is what you'll say. All right? But it's in your bulletin. It's a little white piece of paper. It says, But he lives. But again, don't worry if you don't have a bulletin. I hope we ran out of bulletins today. That'd be a good thing. So, but he lives is your phrase. They tried to stone him in the temple when he proclaimed the greatest news of all time. They tried to stop the joyous fulfillment of prophecy. They mocked him and beat him, hoping that he would die even before he was nailed to that merciless beam. They laughed at him like fools when he said those words of the immortal God, Father, forgive them. They wanted his blood and not his heart. He was nailed to the cross and suffered the torture and humiliation of the entire world. It was placed on his shoulders like a sacrificial lamb led to the altar to appease a holy God. They laughed as he died. They made sure he would be lost forever among the gravestones of eternity. They put a stone that would smother the truth, that would keep the dead in their rightful place. They thought they had seen the last of this man who loved them unconditionally. Yes, he lives. They still want to muffle his grace. They still want to stop his power. They still want to bury the miracle. Praise God, Jesus, King Jesus, lives. Please stand as we sing, Were You There? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when he rose up from the grave? Were you there when he rose up from the grave? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when he rose up from the grave? To see the dawn of the darkest day, rise on the road to Calvary. Tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the path of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame for the wrath we sent, forgiven at the cross. The pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin. Every bitter thought, every evil deed, drowning your bloodstained brow. Is the the daylight flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dead are raised to life, finished the victory cry. Thank you this morning. Oh, what power there is in the cross. Lord, I pray this morning that you be with Brother Dylan as he brings the message from your holy word. And the one thing that we can always remember is the story of your sacrifice for us. Is the living hope that we have as we go from here in our own lives as well as other lives out there that have never accepted you into their hearts. Lord, I pray this morning there might be somebody here or somebody online that's heard this story before, but Lord, this morning you're working in their hearts for them to first realize that they need that living hope in their life. I pray for those folks, whether they be here or online. Lord, help them not to put it off. Thank you again for this time. Thank you for the chance that we have to worship a risen Savior. Forgive us for our sins and fill us with your Spirit. For we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? To pierce the ages, step down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken. I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah.
anointing that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is a victory.
Seated. At this time, children, go out for children's church. You know what? Selfishly this morning, the reason why I paused to quit singing is I wanted to hear you sing. And it's wonderful to hear you singing this morning.
Almost every Sunday that I get up to preach the Word of God, I tell you that it is a joy to be able to stand in this pulpit and to proclaim God's Word. But man, I will just tell you, after the year that we have had and battling this COVID-19 pandemic and having so many Sundays when I would come into this sanctuary and preach to an empty sanctuary and preach to a camera, and after last Easter when I came in and preached to an empty sanctuary and to a camera, to look out and to see all of you worshiping the Lord together and to start our service with a baptism of a young man who has given his heart to Christ, and just to be reminded in that the Lord is at work in our church and in our community. Man, what a joy it is to stand before you today. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is our text this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we will be in verses 1 through 5. If you have a copy of God's Word, if you would go ahead and turn there with me. We'll be taking a break from our sermon series in the book of Ephesians to look at this Easter message on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. When you look at 1 Corinthians, you see that the Apostle Paul is writing to the Corinthian church. And the church in Corinth was a church just like any church today. It was a church that had many problems. Corinth was a major city, and it was a city that was known for its sin. It was known for its idolatry. If you would go into the city of Corinth, you would see these statues of pagan gods, and people would go and they would worship before these pagan gods. But the Lord was at work in this wicked city, and He was saving souls, and the church at Corinth was growing. But one problem that they continually had is this issue of worldliness. The believers at the church in Corinth just couldn't seem to let go of some of those old habits, some of those old behaviors. And as Paul writes to the church at Corinth, out of all the things that he could have laid out for them, out of all the things that he could have nitpicked, Here in chapter 15, he simply lays out the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus Christ, the heart of the Christian message. The title of our message this morning is History's Most Important Message. History's Most Important Message. And what we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is the most important message that any of us will ever hear, that we will ever read. And we'll see that in our text this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I would ask if you would to please rise as we honor the reading of God's holy word. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 1, this is what the word of God says. Now I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold to the message I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I passed on to you as most important what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried, that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Let's pray together. Lord, You have been so good and so kind to us. You have extended grace and mercy where none should be found. Father, we know Your word tells us that each and every one of us stands guilty before You because of our sin. You are a holy God, and You cannot tolerate sin. And Father, we are so thankful that though we could not save ourselves and our own works and our own efforts, that You intervened, that You sent Your only begotten Son to die for our sins, and to not just die, but to rise again 3 days later. Father, we thank You that this morning we have a risen Savior. The universe has a King this morning. This life would be too difficult to bear without the hope of the resurrection. And Your word tells us that we of all people would be most pitied if Christ was not raised from the dead. That is our hope this morning. That is what we want to proclaim. Help us to keep Jesus Christ at the center of our thoughts and our actions today. And Father, I pray that if there are lost individuals in our midst this morning, that through the proclamation of the gospel, the preaching of Your word, that You would save, and that You would do so for Your glory. We pray that You would be glorified in our time together. It's in Your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. I have shared with you all numerous times that I was a server at Cracker Barrel for 8 years. I know I probably sound like a broken record, but we do have some visitors here today. And in that time, 8 years as a server, I learned a lot. I had some great experiences and also had some not so great experiences in those 8 years. But one of the things that I am thankful for is that in those not so great experiences as a server, it has provided me with numerous sermon illustrations that I can use on repeat, that you are probably tired of hearing. But I have shared with you before that one of the things in my 8 years that I learned as a server was that if anybody ordered oatmeal at Cracker Barrel, and please don't be offended or feel judged if you order oatmeal there, but anybody that ever ordered oatmeal, nothing went right. I don't know what it was about oatmeal specifically, but I think that it was cursed. I think that oatmeal is of the devil there. And every time someone would order oatmeal, things would go bad. And I can remember one scenario where I had this, what I thought was a sweet old lady. And I thought, before I worked at Cracker Barrel, that every old lady was sweet. I just thought, if it's an older lady, then she's just going to be automatically sweet. And I soon learned that that's not always the case. And I brought her out her oatmeal, and she was not happy. It was not cooked to her liking. And I remember she shoved that oatmeal back at me, and she yelled at me, "Go back and fix this right." I mean, just yelled at me. And I was taken aback because I thought, well, every old lady is sweet. And she just completely broke that paradigm for me. But one of the things that I've told you before, that as a server, what you so desperately want to communicate to the people you're serving when something goes wrong is that you aren't the one who cooked the food. You're not the one who prepared the meal. You're just delivering it out. You're just taking it out to them. You didn't cook it. You didn't prepare it. And I tell you that because in this text, this is what Paul is communicating when he says in verse 3, "For I passed on to you as most important what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." What Paul is saying here is this gospel message, this good news about Jesus Christ, this message of a suffering Messiah who would come and die for the sins of His people, this Christ that I have been proclaiming, this Christ that I have been beaten for, that I have suffered for, that I have been slandered for, that I have been imprisoned for, this is not some new religion. This is not some new cult that I've started. This is not some new thing. This is what the Scriptures have always taught and have always pointed you to. And I'm delivering to you what I also received. I'm delivering that message to you. And you know, when you read through the Old Testament, you see bits and pieces of this. And I think one of the most beautiful examples in the Old Testament comes from Isaiah chapter 53. This wonderful passage about the suffering servant, who of course we know is Christ. In Isaiah 53, I want to read this for you, and as I do, I want you to think about the message of Jesus. Everything you've ever heard growing up in church, or maybe everything you've ever heard about Christ, the Easter story. Think about that as I read from Isaiah chapter 53. He says, "Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before Him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He didn't have an impressive form or majesty that we should look at Him, no appearance that we should desire Him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like someone that people turned away from. He was despised and we didn't value Him. Yet He Himself bore our sickness and He carried our pains. But we in turn regarded Him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. Because of our rebellion, He was pierced, crushed because of our iniquities. The punishment for our peace was on Him, and we are healed by His wounds. We all went astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way, and the Lord has punished Him for the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, and yet He did not open His mouth, like a lamb led to slaughter, and like a sheep silent before its shears. He was taken away because of oppression and judgment, and who considered His fate? For He was cut off from the land of the living. He was struck because of my people's rebellion. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, but He was with a rich man in His death, because He had done no violence and had not spoken deceitfully. Yet the Lord was pleased to crush Him severely. When you make Him a guilt offering, He will see His seed. He will prolong His days, And by His hands, the Lord's pleasure will be accomplished. After His anguish, He will see light and be satisfied. By His knowledge, my righteous servants will justify many, and He will carry their iniquities. Therefore, I will give Him the many as a portion, and He will receive the mighty as a spoil, because He willingly submitted to death and was counted among the rebels. Yet He bore the sin of many and interceded for the rebels. That was 700 years before Jesus of Nazareth was ever born. 700 years before Jesus was born, and the prophet Isaiah is penning with clarity this message that Paul is laying out for us here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The message of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, this suffering Messiah. This is what Paul means when he says in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 that he passed on what he also received, that the Messiah would come, that he would suffer and die for the sins of his people, and that he would rise again from the grave. But you notice in verse 3, Paul says something interesting. He says, it is of most importance. What is of most importance? He says that Christ died for our sins. It is of most importance that Christ died for our sins. Keep in mind, this is coming from the man who wrote 75% of the New Testament. The man who wrote 1 Corinthians. He wrote Ephesians. He wrote 75% of the New Testament. And he is saying, this is the thing that is of most importance. This is the message that you have to get right. This is the thing that you cannot mess up. And that is that Christ died for our sins. That God's one and only Son would carry a cross and be crucified on it. That He would die for the sins of His people. A gospel message that does not confront sin is no gospel at all. Gospel means good news, and there is no good news in a message that does not confront sin. And I fear that today we live in a society and a culture that has become so familiar with churchy phrases and Christian lingo that when we hear things like John 3:16 or when we read things like this text that Christ died for our sins or we say Jesus died for our sins, that just goes in one ear and out the other. That we just say, yeah, Jesus died for my sins. Of course. Of course I believe in Jesus. But do we really understand what we are saying when we say, Jesus Christ died for my sins? The Son of God died for my sins. You know, we live in a culture that doesn't even believe that there is such a thing as sin, that there is such a thing as truth or right or wrong, that truth is just kind of relative and it's just up to you. Whatever you think is right, and whatever you think is wrong. And, you know, we can't really trust a book that is thousands of years old to tell us what is right and what is wrong. But a gospel message that does not confront sin cannot save. And unless we realize our need of a Savior, we cannot be saved. The gospel must confront sin. This is why Paul says it's of most importance. This is not a negotiable matter for the Apostle Paul. It is of most importance that Christ died for our sins. And the Scriptures tell us that every single one of us is guilty of sin. Every single one of us has sinned before a holy God. We've all fallen short and sin before God. It doesn't matter how good that we think we are. It doesn't matter if we compare ourselves to our neighbor across the street and we think, man, I'm a lot better than that guy, so I think I'm going to be good. We've all sinned. And because of that sin, we are guilty before God. You know, growing up, I would consider myself a pretty good kid. And I didn't get in trouble a lot because I got in trouble a few times when I was little, and I realized I didn't want that to happen again. When I got in trouble with my dad, I didn't want that to happen again. But I had a wonderful idea, I thought, when I was about 3 or 4 years old. I remember my dad, I got in trouble, and he told me to stand in the corner. I don't know if any of you have ever had that punishment where you've had to stand in the corner for however long they tell you to stand in the corner. And I came up with this great idea that I was going to be a revolutionary, that I was going to start a movement. I was going to rebel against my dad, because after he told me that I could get out of the corner, I thought, I'll just stay in the corner. And that'll really show him. And who knows what change that might bring about and reform within our family. And that didn't happen. That didn't happen at all. I didn't try that again. But, you know, I found out very quickly when I had children, and you all can amen this if you have children or grandchildren, you don't have to teach your children to be disobedient. You don't have to teach your children to be self-centered. You don't have to try to find some summer camp or something where you can send them off where they can learn to be disobedient or self-centered. They have that covered. They learn that on their own. And why is that? Because what the Scriptures teach us about man is true. We have a sin nature. We are born in sin. In fact, in Genesis chapter 8, before the flood of Noah, God describes man as evil from his youth. Evil from his youth. And that's why for Paul, this isn't a negotiable matter. This isn't something we can just give up. This isn't something that we can just leave out of the message of the gospel. It is of most importance that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures. In order for us to appreciate the love of God and the great mercy that God has extended to us, we have to understand the weight and the gravity of our guilt before a holy God. You know, you might look at a murderer or somebody who has committed some terrible crime, and you look at them and you look at the sin that they have committed, and you might think, well, man, I'm sure glad that I'm not as bad as that person. I'm sure glad I've never done some wicked thing like that. But before a holy God, we all stand guilty. We all stand condemned. But here's the good news. Paul tells us the good news in verse 4. He says that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. If you look around our sanctuary, we have Easter lilies. And those Easter lilies are placed around our sanctuary in memory of those whom we love who have gone on to be with the Lord. In fact, if you look in your bulletin, there's an insert with the names of those individuals that these Easter lilies are in memory of. And in a way, these lilies are a public testimony to those individuals, to the impact that they've had in our lives, to the impact that they've had on our church. But you know, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a public testimony of God the Father, a public declaration that all of the wrath of God towards sinful men was paid for in Christ. It was absorbed in Christ. And he rose again. That is what we are celebrating today. That is why we celebrate Easter. We have a risen Savior, a risen King. Every day for a believer should be celebrated by celebrating a risen Christ, a risen Savior. And no matter how dark the trials of life may be that we face, no matter how difficult things may get, we can look to the cross and look to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and know as his children that God is for us. He is not against us. He has given his Son. to die for our sins, and he rose again, defeated death, hell, and the grave, taking away the sting of death. You might look at your past and think about all of the wicked things that you have done. Think about all of the sinful things that you have done and think, man, how could God ever love me? How could God not be ashamed of me? How could God forgive me? If you only knew the wicked things, the sinful things that I have done. But God is ashamed of that sin, and that's why he paid for it with the death of his only begotten Son. He paid the debt in full, and he rose again. John MacArthur has a quote that I love. He says that every sin that has ever been committed by you or against you, every sin that has ever been committed will be paid for in one of two places. It will either be paid for by an eternity in hell under the wrath of God, or it will have been paid for on Calvary's cross in the death of God's only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't it amazing that someone can sin for 50 or 60 years, break every law, break every commandment that God has ever given, and one drop of the precious blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse them whiter than snow, can cast their sin farther than the east is from the west. And no matter how dark or how checkered your past may be or the sin that you have committed, if you come to the cross, you come to Christ in humility, seeking forgiveness, forgiveness can be found. That is good news. Amen. That a holy God would make a way for a sinful people like us to be reconciled to him, to be brought back to him. You know, I'm 26 years old, and I am continually amazed at how many people that I graduated high school with who are not alive right now, who have lost their life because of some circumstances or another. But the older I get, and even though I don't feel that I'm that old, the older I get, the more I realize how true it is that this life really is a vapor. It doesn't matter how young, it doesn't matter how old, we don't know how long we have. We don't know how much time the Lord has allotted us on this earth. And the most important decision that we could ever make is to put our faith and trust in this risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I would ask every single one of you here this morning, and I know on Easter Sunday, it is likely that there are some here who have never trusted in Christ. I would ask you, have you put your faith and trust in this risen Savior, the one who died for our sins, paid the bill in full, and rose again from the grave victorious over death? Have you put your faith and trust in him? If you haven't, the most important decision that you could ever make is to trust in him right now, to turn from your sins and turn to a risen Savior. We have an invitation in just a few moments. If you've never done that, come. Come and say, I'm trusting in this Christ. I want to know this risen Savior, this one who has defeated death. I want to have a relationship with him. I want to have my sins forgiven. And for the believers here, I would challenge you. This day is about so much more than chocolate bunnies and Easter eggs, and that's fun. But this day is about so much more than that. We serve a risen King, a risen Savior. The universe has a King. And sometimes on the darkest days, that is the only thing that can keep you going. That is the only thing that can give you hope for tomorrow, to know that Christ has been raised. And as we said this morning, he lives. Amen. He lives. Might we always live in light of that? Let's pray together. Father, the message of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ that Paul speaks of here is so simple that a young child can understand it, but it's so profound at the same time that we will spend all of eternity trying to wrap our minds around the price that was paid for us on Calvary's cross, around the debt that was canceled on that cross when you gave your Son. Father, we have all sinned against you. We're all guilty in your sight. And even our best works are like filthy rags before you. If it was up to us to save ourselves, we wouldn't have a chance. If it was up to us to find hope in ourselves, there would be no hope to be found. And so we thank you that you, in your grace and in your mercy, stepped in and that you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the God-man, to live a perfect life without sin and to die as our substitute, paying the penalty, paying the price that we should have paid for our sins, and that he rose again. Father, we are so thankful to serve a risen Savior. We're so thankful that the resurrection gives us hope, even when everything else in this life might seem to be spiraling out of control and we don't understand why certain things are happening, to know that he lives. What a joy. What a comfort it is. And Father, I pray that everyone here this morning has that joy, has that assurance. I pray that they know this risen Savior. And Lord, if there's someone here who has never trusted in Christ, I pray and I ask that today would be the day of salvation, that they would see and understand the full weight of their sin and their guilt before you, and that you have provided your Son as a substitute for that sin. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Please stand as we sing The Nail-Scarred Hand. Have you failed in your plan of your storm-tossed life? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you weary and worn from its toll and strife? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you walking alone through the shadows dim? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Christ will comfort your heart. Put your trust in him. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Let's sing one more verse. Would you follow the will of the risen Lord? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Would you live in the light of his blessed word? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand.
Well, so much for coming out to worship the Lord with us on this Easter Sunday. I told you, it is such a joy to look out and to see you all praising the Lord together. What a blessing that is. And what a blessing it is to know that we have a risen Savior. And not only that, but He is still at work saving souls. And we saw evidence of that this morning in the baptism of Lane. And we are so thankful for that. If I didn't get a chance to meet you or talk to you, if you're visiting with us this morning, I'll be at the door up front here. I would love to talk with you, to meet you if we never have met on your way out. And as I say every Sunday, if there's a decision that is laid on your heart, the Lord is dealing with your heart, I would love to talk with you about how He's working in your life. Monty, I think we have a few announcements.
I have very quickly, I'm going to do this. If you'll have a seat, I'm going to real quickly tell you the announcements. No evening activities today. No evening activities. Lord's Supper will be next Sunday morning. There won't be any meeting of Awana again next Sunday night. And we have a church cleanup day on May the 1st. The last thing, I want to leave this for last, and that is our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, which we'll be doing for another couple weeks for North American Missions. Our church goal is $2,200, and you have given $2,215. So we reached our goals. Give a big hand for that. Any other announcements?
Just some prayer.
Sure. Let's everyone stand as we close in prayer. And again, we're glad you're here this morning. Dear God, as we leave here this morning, we are so thankful for this message of knowing what You have done for us. Lord, I pray this morning as we leave here, if we've never accepted You in our hearts and we're thinking about it or contemplating about it, Lord, that those that feel that way would make that decision soon and not put it off. Lord, I pray for those that are believers as they leave here, that we have the message that this world needs to hear. And Lord, we wouldn't just hide it under a bushel, but we would share that light with others. Help us to share what people are looking for, because that's the only thing that will fill the hole that they have in their heart. Thank You again for this time. Thank You for this congregation. Thank You for those online. Lord, help us as we continue to celebrate You being our risen Savior today. Thank You. Thank You for this day. Thank You for Your love and Your forgiveness. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.